Hello, welcome to the Connective Tissue Lecture for Functional Mobilization 1 course. My name is Kent Kaiser, and I'm a senior faculty with the Institute of Physical Art. And professionally, I'm a physical therapist and manual therapist and anatomist. So when we get into this lecture, we're going to have a talk about connective tissue that looks at elements of histology, biochemistry, and biomechanics in regards to connective tissue and its importance and relevance to manual therapy, and in particular, myofascial techniques that you'll be learning in the class. We feel it is important to go over some of the basics in this area to get ourselves back to the why, and you know, what are we doing when we lay hands on people to release tissues. So there are times confusion now, especially with so many different ideas coming in and approaches. We want to be open-minded, you know, so that we're looking at some of the claims, but they're also very empirical at times, and also there's a lot of just in research status only. So we want to be as scientific as possible in our inquiry to help us with clinical decision-making with related to our treatment approaches. So I do not have an expertise in biochemistry, but I do have a long interest in connective tissue due to all the fascinating findings I've run into across 9 years of dissection at university level. You know, you ask yourself the question, how much did you learn in connective tissue in school? You know, probably not enough. And so at this point, the scientific information we present are from classic information, classic types of articles and different research, but as well, it's going to be looking at some exciting new areas of research that is coming out at this time. So just by way of functional anatomy, we will talk about connective tissue. Connective tissue is one of four types of biological tissue in the traditional classifications. The others, as you notice on the list, being epithelial, muscle, and nervous tissue. It is characterized by abundant extracellular matrix encasing relatively few cells. The various combination of the elements in this intracellular matrix gives us the tissue its character, resulting in different kinds of connective tissue. All connective tissues are of mesodermal origin. So embryologically, from the 42 somites, there are individual quilts laid down, and then in the process, embryologically, the body puts those together in a welded type of form, so it's continuous throughout the body. So you think about when you look at a person that has skin from the top of the head to their feet, that's all one continuous piece, and in itself, that's an amazing thing. But with a fascia underneath, as you peel the skin off, you have that same layer from top to bottom. But at the skull, through the sutures, you have continuous layers of fascia going down, becoming the separation of the hemispheres of the brain underneath to the tentorum, then down into the spinal cord coverings, separating all those pieces, and more going out around the vertebral bodies all the way down, as well as out into the tissues and the various levels in the neck, the pectoral fascia, down to the abdomen in three layers, as well as becoming the peritoneum in itself. Into the pelvis, we become five layers of fascia that then in comes out in layers of fascia around the lower extremity, known as the fascia lata, of course, all the way down to the feet. This is an amazing web. Think about all of that is intertwined and all in one continuous piece. So when we think about the development of these mesodermal tissues, we know that from Wolff's law that we learned in school that we have arrangement and specialization of connective tissue, and it is dependent on intermittent stresses that's placed upon them. Just to let you know that with soft tissue, we call this Davies' laws. Just like to mention the classic works of Wolff, Buntings, and Eddies, Salter of CPM fame, Bassett, Arum, and Madden. So on the slide you see the types of connective tissue listed there. In particular, we're going to be paying attention to regular connective tissue, which includes tendon, ligaments, and most of all, we're going to pay attention to the irregular types of fascia, which is a dense and loose. This is what we'll focus on in the class. Here's a very nice picture from Gray's Anatomy of regular connective tissue, dense type, that's a tendon. These are regular bundles of mostly collagenous tissue in parallel alignment. They're made to withstand longitudinal stresses, not perpendicular stresses. I like to think about tendons as an analogy when I like to visit San Francisco. Some of you might have been to the Golden Gate Bridge. There's a little park that has a large piece of cable that shows you what holds up the bridge. It's 6 foot in diameter, and so from distance you go, wow, that is just a large one bundle. But as you get closer, you see individual bundles within that large bundle. And as you get closer, continue to see bundles until you're finally down to millions of copper wire. And it's an amazing thing to see. And this is how we think of what a tendon is like. It comes from the fascia that comes off of muscle, that epimysium, paramysium, and endomysium coming together and winding together into this very dense tendinous piece of tissue. When we think about these things, we know that it has very, very strong directional characteristic. This is given to us by information from S.L. Wu in 1977, who coined the phrase ancinotrophy. A lot of these fibers, even though very strong, are held together by delicate cross fibers, and these are bound by a layer of loose connective tissue. Here we see another picture from Gray's Anatomy of regular connective tissue, which is ligament, which is a dense collagenous tissue as well, which is less regular than the tendinous tissue. It possesses a spiral and oblique arrangement, as you can tell. These ligaments are tough, pliant, and flexible without resisting movement and formed to withstand multiplanar stretch. A good example of how the body is amazing with use of this kind of tissue is the medial collateral ligament, where we're crossing the knee. It is very stiff and tight tissue, but because of the isometry, that being the way that the architecture of the ligament is laid down, we have this great ability for range of motion in our knee. So here we have a compliant, very tough tissue, but that we have great movement ability as well, which is an amazing thing. Here we have a nice electron microscopic picture of tendon. I wanted you to see the natural crimp related to the toe phase of the stress strain curve. So all tissues have an initial, a little bit of crimp in it, so that can be taken out without any strain being put upon it. Now we're looking at a great picture of fascia, which is irregular connective tissue. This includes dense and loose connective tissues. Now the emphasis of the course material is in the evaluation and treatment of irregular connective tissue, or fascia, which is composed of irregular sheaths of collagen and elastin fibers. These fascial sheaths are continuous with each other, which we talked about earlier, interweaving and enveloping all over the structures of the body, from the basement membrane of the dermis to the periosteum of the bone, and from proximal to distal regions. Look at this electron microscopic picture of dense irregular connective tissue. Looks like Rastafarian hairdo, doesn't it? Can you note the irregular weave that we talked about? As it says in the slides, we note that the superficial elements are thinner and more delicate, allowing for skin mobility, while deeper elements are thicker, stronger, as they separate and support surrounding structures. Parallel sheaths and fibers laying at angles to each other is what we'll find when we look at this particular types of fascial elements. And this also provides, again, a greater strength and extensibility. Because I mentioned earlier basement membrane, I thought you'd like to see just a picture to descripting where that's at. The basement membrane is a thin sheet of fibers, a mat-like structure upon which the epithelium, which lines the cavities and surfaces of organs, including skin, or the endothelium, which lines the interior surface of blood vessels, lie. You can see on that upper picture where that gives a break between that skin level and our superficial fascia below and the dermal layer. On this slide, I just wanted you to see that deep attachment. We can see that attachment strength and the fluid connection throughout. Notice the parallel fibers and sheaths of the picture that we have here of the thoracolumbar fascia. Note that they're arranged at angles to each other to provide greater strength and extensibility. Here's just a picture up close to see those fibers in the parallel arrangement on the shin of a cadaver. Be aware of this picture because many times during this talk you'll be thinking about the support of nature and how this tissue runs at particular angles to each other for its different functions. Fascia withstands three-dimensional stresses. Henry Hollingshead, who is a physician who created a very excellent anatomy book and it has much fame with that, once said that if you take a skeleton out of a body and it has all its fascia remaining, it will stand. But if you take the fascia off and have the skeleton in its complete ability to hold there, it will crumple to the ground in a hump and a mess. So here in the pictures, I put a little bit of marketing for Body Worlds. I use that example because I know most of you have probably been able to see this wonderful cadaveric exposition somewhere. My favorite one is the connective tissue, that's the arterial system, when they've taken latex through that portion but got rid of all the other organic parts of the body. And without any wires or other connective devices, the person they call artery man can be able to stand and fully be supported. Probably that is a great comment to what Hollingshead said. A lot of what we see from this kind of three-dimensional stress is an understanding that first came from investment dissections done by Frederick Becker, a DO from Michigan State University. Ida Rolf uses a sweater and a weave to identify the effect from distance. If you were to sitting there in the audience, listen, take a shirt and be able to take your left hand, grab a hold of your shirt on the bottom of your right side, kind of where your appendix would be. Hold that tight and try to raise your arm and notice that through distance you have a reduction of the motion of your arm. Kind of that idea of being pulling on a sweater and having a line be pulling through that. So we know that the weave has an extensibility throughout, and so something at distance within the fascia can cause strain somewhere else. It's not always a local environment. Within that idea, there are spaces between those sweater, in that sweater idea. And we take an idea from a researcher named Gratz in 1938. Actually, his research was 1926 to 1938, where he was looking at how to maybe separate scar tissue in victims that had been burned. He was using rabbits and using air to try to go underneath scar and blow it apart. I feel sorry for the rabbits. But what he found was that there was individual spaces and between all fibers in the body. From that, we kind of coined a term, a functional joint. So if you think about working in manual therapy and using your hands on joints, and how many joints, 200 something joints in the body, but imagine how many joints if you consider every space between every piece of muscle and fascia in the body. So in the course, you'll have a lot of work to be doing, and it'll be a lot of fun. So we looked at classical ideas of Ida Rolf with a sweater, we commented on here. It's interesting to note that the thought before was that individual fibers of the fascia it stretched itself. Newer research we're going to be talking about shows that the fascia in itself probably doesn't stretch, but it's actually the extracellular matrix and its constituency that has to give us the mobility throughout the system. When we talked about tendon earlier, I was talking about the sheath of fascia coming off muscle to create that tendon. Here we have a picture that shows the individual muscles fibers are covered by this endomysium, groups of fibers covered by the paramysium, and the entire muscle covered by the epimysium, all of which are considered fascial sheaths. As it says on your PowerPoint, you see that 10% of the muscle mass is fascia, which forms into that tendon that we talked about earlier. Most of the observable contours of the body are based on the arrangement of underlying fascia. So stretch and recoil fascia, although we may be talking about extracellular matrix, enhances the continuity of movement and promotes smooth diagonal and spiral movement patterns. Again, newer research, as I said, shows the mobility is really from the extracellular matrix components. Here's another beautiful picture of muscles that's been taken away, and all we're seeing is the fascia that looks like a honeycomb. And we know how strong a honeycomb is in supporting the beehive. We know that some evidence suggests that fascia may be able to actively contract, further influencing musculoskeletal dynamics. The original work by Carol Lewitt, MD, in his book of Manipulative Therapy and Rehabilitation of the Locomotor System, was the first one to really look at that at some time ago in the late 80s. Since then, we'll be talking about more evidence that this is a fact about contractile element of deeper fascial tissues. Although I mentioned that this is newer thoughts about research related to this mobility and contractility, it's interesting to note that in 1994 in Scientific American, there was a whole article on what's called life's architecture with extracellular matrix and tensegrity structure. And so this was from work from Giuliano Gabbiani in 1988 and Carl Lewitt in 1991. They had the first early hypothesis and research of fibroblasts and the characteristics of fascial plasticity. That information, once it was out as hypothesis, kind of stood for about 10 to 12 years before people really began to have the equipment to research and look at the evidence for what they thought originally. Recently, Schleep, Klingler, et al. Have looked at fascia and show that it is populated by myofibroblasts and is therefore able to actively contract and relax over a period of minutes or hours. This capacity seems to be especially expressed in human lumbar dorsal fascia. the potential tonus changes in the fascia are strong enough to be palpable and to impact musculoskeletal dynamics, such as through gamma motor regulation, for example. This suggests that fascial tonicity may be an important and previously overlooked factor influencing low back stability. It offers interesting implication for fascia-directed therapy. Here we have a very nice stained slide of alpha smooth muscle actin. Schliep, Klingler, and Lehmann-Horn out of Germany discovered these particular cells related to connective tissue in about 2005. They've been seen in many other research for a while, but particularly that the actin of connective tissue would show that it has contractility. Helene Langevin, who is a famous researcher, has a very nice article that talks about a hypothesis and looking at research that unspecialized loose connective tissue forms an anatomical network throughout the body. Her paper presents the hypothesis that in addition, connective tissue functions as a body-wide mechanosensitive signaling system. And these three categories of signals are electrical, cellular, and tissue remodeling. So if you imagine what we talked about with the body having that three-dimensional characteristics from the embryological state that were welded together, right? And here now the researchers are showing that not just muscle like I learned in school with kinesiology, origin to insertion, but now we have tissue that can run from long distances and cause movement there, kind of like Audie Rolf's sweater idea. This is very important, especially that they're looking at neuroscience-wise, that these are a neural network of connection for contractility and the body having automatic movement patterns. So those of you that learn kinesiology, the future is going to be different. You're going to be learning a whole new kinesiology in the next few years, I'm sure. So with all that excitement about what we're seeing in the new research, we do know from our just models of understanding the nerves related to fascia, that we have multifascular peripheral nerves running through all the tissues. As it says on the slide, 30-70% of the peripheral nerves is connective tissue. Nerves go under compression all the time. People think that because you have compression, that's how you get injury. It's much more complicated than that. But in general, the fascia is a protective element for the neural elements. On this continued picture of the peripheral nerve, we know that the nervous tissue has a lot of blood vessels that weave through it and are spiral in nature through the connective tissue and throughout its course. This allows the nerve to have extensibility without putting too much stress on the neural and vascular components as stated. One of the segues from that article we talked about with the body-wide signaling from Langevin is that where it's very important that we have nutrition being healthy in the region so that the blood supply to the nerves. We know that nerves are the most bloodthirsty and need a lot of nutrition. So the nerve having good blood supply will keep the fascia communication, the signaling, healthy. So this is what provides us the proper fibrogenesis to occur so that we can heal injuries. As you look at the comments about functions of fascia, we just sort of stop for a moment and just admire the picture from Luis Lopez Antunes, who is an MD, PhD, that anatomist at the University of Mexico provided a beautiful text on color and atlas of human anatomy. One of the few people that really did three-dimensional look at the fascia throughout different body parts. This is a very difficult book to get as it's out of publication, and anytime I'm able to get one copy, I'm very excited. You can see that we have the connective tissue and its continuous nature from its basement membrane of the dermis to the periosteum in this picture. If you look at the picture, you're seeing that you're looking at an anterior thigh, of course, and you're looking at the different levels of support all the way through, from small fascicles and fibrils all the way out to covering around the whole muscle. As this is continuous throughout the whole body, as we discussed, it provides different functions for us of absorbing and attenuating shock, transmitting mechanical force. It provides us a ability to have space and divider for muscle play, which is the ability for tissues to glide and slide freely over each other. We'll talk about that later. This also fascia that comes into this different roles here allows independent functions, elongating, shortening. It varies in strength to the functional demands put upon it. It has deeper tissues, which we said are thicker and stronger, to give us a strong support to the bone. It supports all through the vital organs and structures and certainly has metabolic function. As we continue to admire the fascia picture of Lopez Antunes, it's also important to remind you that one of the couple of functions that are very important for fascia is that it protects against the spread of infection. as it has that metabolic function. Both of those, again, as important as the mechanical aspects. Muscle play, which is a synthesis of my good friend Greg Johnson, uses as a term to kind of help us understand the normal accessory mobility of muscle, as you see on your slide. This could be true of surrounding muscles, neurovascular structures, or bony structures. If you lose this in a dysfunctional state, you're going to alter the functional capacity of those structures. Probably synthesized from the idea in manual therapy of joint play by John Monell, who is a famous physician who you can read about his ideas through the bony structures related to this in his book written in 1983. If you just take and do a little demonstration for me while I'm working with you on the video, I would like to take your arm, grab your upper humeral area, and I want you to slide the soft tissue around the humerus. This is muscle play, any of the tissues being able to slide and glide upon another. But it can also go up and down. It doesn't have to be any one direction, it can go diagonals. Conversely, you can also take the arm, hold the soft tissue still, and move the humerus inside. So everything is able to move functionally and thoroughly. I always think about the swimmers in the Olympics as they are shaking their body parts out, and you can see every sinewy muscle moving. You know, they're not flabby. They have beautiful muscle play. Well, this is an interesting anatomy picture on the slide. Take a moment to consider, what muscle is it? Can you tell? It's a really interesting picture from Bob Donatelli. And when we look at it, we see that it's actually the serratus anterior. Now, how many of you have ever done a cadaver dissection and you saw the serratus anterior and thought it was supposed to be plastered down on the ribs? Here shows true muscle play and what muscles and tissue and fascia should be able to do when they are moving properly on a person in an optimal state. Here's another beautiful picture from Lopez Antunes's book. Sorry about a little bit of the graphic detail. But can you see in his three-dimensional picture here, if you were imagining that left side having some kind of scar, or if it was the right side with an appendix scar, how that might go all the way along the psoas to the spine in the back and could create some kind of back problems. Most of us know that the abdomen and that whole area is really the front of the back. Not all patients really understanding that. So if we have this understanding of the front of the back, what if it is true that there's all this contractility in the fascia, and how is that going to create all kinds of dysfunction through there? We have a lot of good references that show for this idea of the thoracolumbar fascia and all the fascia that comes into the tissues that we are now calling the core elements that we have from the Australian studies. We have a good understanding of the aponeurotic roots of thoracolumbar fascia from Willard and Correa. And we also have the understanding of force closures and form closure ideas from Andre Fleming. So there is a lot of good research looking at mechanical aspects. If we add the idea of contractility, we really do need to be good at our three-dimensional anatomy. You know, I want you to think about the things we're looking at. They're very exciting, but I don't want it to get too bogged down, because we want to think of these things also in nice, simple, straightforward ways that make us, as a clinician, comfortable. So when we look at the next slide, composition of fascia, I want you to think of things in just kind of a simple way and a practical way. So when we think about fascia, we have fibers and non-fibers. That's basically it. If we put under fibers, we have collagen fibers, elastin, and fibroblasts, cells that actually are fibrous in nature. And then the non-fiber is the extracellular matrix that we alluded to and talked about a little bit earlier. So this is how we're going to be looking at these different things in a somewhat practical and simpler way at first. Here's another nice picture from Gray's Anatomy. This is of collagen fibers, which is the most prolific loose connective tissue fiber we're going to find in the body. The connective tissue that we find there is primarily type 1, which is the emphasis that we're going to be doing in the class. It's in tendons, ligaments, fascia, and capsules. Collagen is that type 1 collagen, as we said, is high tensile strength and able to withstand about one half of the stress tolerated by cortical bone. That's pretty amazing. We've seen much of that research from Akison, Wu, Emil, Kuti, and Daniels. These are people's names that are been long-standing experts in the area of collagen. Collagen fibers function to resist tensile strength, and their ability to elongate is limited individually by about to 3 to 8 degrees of their length. if we had individual fibers, and I hope you can see that, there's a nice mat that in its whole put together, it has a lot of ability to slide and glide. I don't know if you play with these kind of things at when you're out at a restaurant, but if you took the individual portion of the fiber in there out and we try to pull on it by itself, it would not give very much. So think of collagen as very, very strong individually, but when we put it together in a weave, it has a lot of extensibility. We're not going to talk too much about fibrogenesis, but enough to say that when we have production of tissues in the body through fibrogenesis, this is a beautiful picture of showing the collagen coming from a little tropocollagen chain into a filament, a fiber, a small primitive collagen into a nice fully matured collagen fiber. And this is from a very nice picture from wound repair from Peacock and Van Winkle in 1976. But when we look at that, it's really interesting to think about how does that actually form like that. When we look at the formation of these mature, I'll have this little bit of cotton to give us an idea. It's very loose and pulls apart very easy. But we have this triple helix formation that occurs with this fibrogenesis into these collagen fibers. So as I take the fibers and I bring them into close contact and twist them, how strong it becomes. And this is the idea of collagen, that it begins very wispy, but as it forms into these final fibers, it becomes a triple helix, if you will, and very, very strong. So as you see this list, collagen health is depending on a variety of different things. Certainly we need stress through the body, physical exercise, and we need good nutrition that we need to have. And we talked about the nutrition necessary for the health of the nerve so that we can have those communication systems that we talked about earlier. The connective tissue is also dependent on vitamin C. Vitamin C is very important to keeping the dynamics of the tissue healthy. We also know, of course, that steroids impair collagen production. But you know, in recent research, it's not just prednisone that we have to worry about. How many of you have people that use nasal inhalants or puffers for, again, exercise-induced asthma? They don't even put that down on their medication list. But that can be a real problem because the research shows any kind of steroid in the system can be deleterious to ligaments and various other structures in the body. So we have to be really vigilant with that. We also know that impaired nerve root causes target tissues to be a problem. What do I mean? Some of you may have heard the term double crush syndrome. So you have somebody who comes in with a chronic tennis elbow carpal tunnel syndrome and you're just working on it and it's not getting better, just to find out later that they have some silent neck problem. The way that nerves get that give information is that they provide that axioplasmic flow of coming down. The neurotransmitters come and tell the nervous system at the site and chemicals to repair themselves. And so if you have good neurotransmitter flow, you're saying, hey, bring in some brick and mortar to fix things. But if you have some unhealth in your nervous system, then you're saying, hey, just some straw and mud. And if you're not lucky, just mud. So if you get the analogy, what we do is have people that have poor nervous system information to their tissues, they're going to have poor connective tissue. And so we're thinking we're doing a great job getting things healing, and they keep having return and recidivism of the problem. So it's important to be able to scan and look at the whole nervous system as a part of good health throughout the body. So if you remember the last slide, it showed that the connective tissue has a 500-day half-life. That equates to the whole connective system is turned over in about 3.5 years. So it's important to let people know as they're trying to get back from chronic types of problems, maybe complex regional pain syndrome, that it's going to take time for their connective tissue really to get healthy. It doesn't happen necessarily real fast. So we keep that in mind as we give advisement to our clients. So the next part of that fiber components that we were looking at after collagen is elastin. And elastin is a protein. Elastin, of course, protein, and it's got microfibrillar protein core that is attached to. It's not water element oriented, which means it's hydrophobic. This is important when we talk about some things later. It's also a double twist, not a triple twist like the collagen. We're going to find this in cartilage, aorta, skin, ligamentum flavum, for example, where we think about yellow elastic ligament. These fibers are smaller, more uniform in size than collagen fiber, and provide about 4/5 of the tensile strength, so it's not near as strong. But the healthy fibers can elongate to 150 to 200% of their original length with perfect recoil and compress to half their normal volume. However, with aging or prolonged stretching, these fibers can often calcify or become overstretched and lose their elasticity. This is called elastocalcinosis. When you see this picture, it's a beautiful picture, contrast of skin. We see the perfect elastin of the young baby and the elastocalcinosis, the wrinkles, if you will, of the older person. Being a little older myself, I kind of think of that not as a disease, but a part of maturing and of age. The final part of the fibrous elements that we're talking about is the fibroblasts. They are the most prolific cellular elements. They are our structure, excuse me, and they synthesize all the connective tissue fibers through use of putting together the amino acids that you noted earlier on the slide. They form hydrostatic covalent bonds to strengthen structures. When we think of fibroblastic collagen synthesis, we're usually putting together different amino acids, the primary ones being proline, lysine, and glycine. But we also have hydroxyproline, which is a part of keeping the water matrix going. These three alpha chains combine by hydrogen bonds to form the tropic collagen that we were talking about. Tropic collagen binds to form the fibrils, therefore coming to finally the mature fibers that we talked about earlier. Notice the nice electron microscopic picture of the fibroblasts. In many ways, they look like mitochondria and do function as a little powerhouse. In this picture, I have shown a kind of graphic drawing of cellular adhesion molecules. These are related to fibroblasts in that they are particular cells that help attach the fibroblast bond. It's interesting with the fibroblasts, when they get laid down, the stress that's applied to them, they will line up longitudinal or perpendicular to the stress. What do I mean both longitudinal or perpendicular? If you think about friction massage, why is it that we do it transversely? It's because when we move transversely across the body part, physics-wise, it's like lining up a lot of pickup sticks. Now, I know some of you are young and you might not, younger than I am, and you might not have played pickup sticks, but most of you guys know what that is. And if you have a whole bunch of them and you don't want to pick them up off the ground, you're going to rub your hand perpendicular to them and they will line up perpendicular to a bundle. And this is why transverse friction massage is not diagonal friction massage, etc. But interesting enough, when we give people exercises usually cause the muscle stress in a longitudinal or parallel fashion to the muscle to help it build. So the body's amazing that it can take this different information of stresses and allow the fibroblasts to lay down so that they can spew out their different components for either the fibrous or the non-fibrous elements. The adhesion molecules have been found recently to be very important in cancer research. Just a little comment about that. We understand what they're doing with the CAMs are they're manipulating those cells in leukemia, and they cause the leukemia to turn into a tumor in a mouse or a rat in experiment. Isn't that amazing? Because then you can just take the leukemia out is the goal. In tumors, when you manipulate the CAMs, they turn into liquid and the body then dissipates it and gets it out. So it's very important for cancer research, but we can use this knowledge related to what we're doing with soft tissue, because when we apply forces, we're stimulating and using these CAMs to help lay down the tissue in a proper way and function correctly. I have another picture here of the CAM molecules, both of an electron microscopic picture and a stain. I think they're pretty interesting looking. But just to realize, these early studies, and I understand from this, have been written about in Nature Review Neuroscience by Dalva, McClellan, and Kaiser, 2007. Adhesion molecules are known to interact with a number of intercellular signaling molecules that influence synaptic strength. Remember our discussion of the body-wise signaling system? This is an important aspect of it from these cells. It's interesting, though, that normally we like to find out about this kind of information from frontline medical journals or our own physical therapy journals, etc. But the first exposure for most of us was from a Time journal in 1992, where there was a medical article on the glue of life, and again, related to how the researchers were using this related to arthritis and cancer or for the cure. Hopefully they'll be able to do that. I think we can think of therapies that could be affected with use of our hands that might affect these related to soft tissue. Of course, that's my emphasis or my thought.